Dear students, members of the faculty, administration and staff, honored guests, and beautiful denizens of this complicated city, on behalf of Habib University, may I extend to you my warmest and deepest wishes of welcome. I would have said khush amdeed, but it's not mango season, so. Well, anyway, thank you all for being here. It's such a wonderful crowd. We're absolutely delighted that you take out the time this afternoon. Before I officially commence Habib University's 8th annual Yosin lecture, may I invite onto the stage Basil Ali Khan, class of 2026, computer science major, for a recitation from the Holy Quran.
A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. ألم نشرح لك صدرك ووضعنا عنك وزرك الذي أنقض ظهرك ورفعنا لك ذكرك فإن مع العسر يسرا مع العسر يسرا فإذا فرغت فانصب وإلى ربك فارغب. In the name of Allah, the most gracious, the most merciful. Did we not expand for you, O Muhammad, your breast? And we removed from you your burden, which had weighed upon your back, and raised high for you your repute. For indeed, with hardship will be ease. Indeed, with hardship will be ease. So, when you have finished your duties, then stand up for worship. And to your Lord, direct your longing. Sadaqallahu al-Azim.
Well, before I begin, it's also my distinct pleasure and honor to welcome our fabulous star speaker today, a world-renowned oncologist, Dr. Azra Raza. The Yosin Lecture is Habib's flagship public lecture series, sponsored by the Office of the President and guided by the university's ethos of beautiful, thoughtful, intellectual engagement. The Yosin series brings the most distinguished scholars, artists, and critics of our time to Habib University. Not that she needs any further accolades, but for us, Dr. Raza will be joining an elect and certainly prized and special group of scholars and public intellectuals, many of whom in the past years have graced this very podium, including speakers like Dr. Munir Fassi, Dr. Wali Raza Nasir, Dr. Deborah Fitzgerald, Dr. Raza Aslan, Dr. Maria Clough, Noam Chomsky, and Dr. Ashish Nandi. Noam Chomsky is also a doctor, but yeah. Some of these names, I'm sure, ring a definitive bell. You know, it's a very strange world. When I was asked to host, I'm going to be host, not MC today. When I was asked to host this year's Yosin Lecture, which is coupled with a talk on the global cancer crisis, I was immediately struck by a series of very intimate connections. So you see, my father, and I don't mean to be autobiographical, but I'll connect this. My father was born in London in 1937, and his German mother, Edith Florence, named him Brian. And for those of you who don't speak Irish, Brian means noble or high. He certainly was an honest and noble man in every sense of the word. My grandfather, Abdullah John, however, named him Habib, beloved. And as you all know, this stems from the root word for love, hub. Some 30 years later, this mischievous devil, yours truly, was born. And I'm not sure if it was intentional, but my beautiful mother, Yasmin, named me Najib, which, like Brian, also means noble. It is, of course, the strangest, most Ajib name. I've never really been fond of it at all. And I would have changed it had it not been for this connection or meaning forged by my mother, Yasmin, or as I like to call her, Yas Queen. But I hope she's not listening. Of course, the word mean in Yasmin is just a coincidental, it's a coincidental act of bilingual punning. But Yasmin actually also means, in addition to the flower, it also means a gift from God. And she certainly has been that. I would not be this curious, misguided fool if it were not for her labors. Anyway, so back to the story. Sometimes in the mid-90s, my father, Brian Habib John, was diagnosed with prostate cancer. And I remember when he told me the news, I was quite devastated. And he said to me, I remember he was saying something to the effect, he said, "Have you heard the good news?" And I was like, "What good news? You've been diagnosed with cancer." He said, "My son's name is Naveed. Naveed means good news. And the good news is that my son is an oncologist." So we took hope from this brief moment, this coincidence of names. But despite receiving the best possible care from my brother and his family and our entire family, his cancer metastasized, and as the century came to a close, he passed away at the age of 63. Both of Habib John's sons were doctors, one an oncologist and me an ontologist. That's one of the areas I like to think I work on, is critical ontology. I'll say a little bit more about that. But sadly, and one of my major regrets was that he never saw me transition from little idiot to an even bigger idiot with a PhD. Whenever me and my brother, however, are introduced, you know, they'll say, "This is Dr. John, this is Dr. John." I always have to sort of say, "Well, you know, he's the real doctor." It has become somewhat glib, even trite perhaps, to remark that we are living in dark times, with fascist energies intensifying around the globe, genocides being normalized in front of our very eyes, and the looming threat of planetary ecological collapse. We recognize that the Earth in this age of the Anthropocene itself has formed a terminal cancer. The modern human has itself become a disease. It suffers from what I call the humanities, right? So the world, not just the body, is in crisis with a form of cancer. And perhaps it is here that we see a momentary coincidence or overlap between ontology and oncology. What, after all, is cancer? And forgive me for massively oversimplifying your area of specialty, but cancer occurs at the level of mitosis when cells are genetically altered and proliferate rapidly and indefinitely. In her award-winning bestseller, The First Cell, Dr. Azra Raza's highly acclaimed book, she suggests that a major characteristic of cancer is runaway tissue growth, quote. Cancer can also be seen when the growth or arresting signal is lacking, right? And she has a technical name for that. So cancer is what happens, now to give this a kind of an ontological twist, cancer is what happens when a cell refuses its own impotentiality, its potential not to. It's a cell that therefore fails to recognize its own limits and thereby transforms the body into a site of ceaseless activity of overproduction, reproduction, and consumption. That sounds a lot like capitalism, which is fundamentally about maximizing. Unfortunately, yes, it's about maximizing and actualizing every last ounce of human potential, right? Captured most elegantly in this famous Pepsi slogan, "Why not Mary John?" Right? Like the thing that we need to do is not ask why, you know, what we can do, but what is also we cannot do. This is also a very important question. So here is my speculative, and I'll be very quick, contribution to this grave issue. The point at which ontology and oncology coincide. If I were to sum up and simplify the ontological critique of our global oncology, our global cancer, I would say that all the major modern political systems in which we are consigned to live with, nationalism, liberalism, capitalism, socialism, neoliberalism, Islamism, Zionism, these are all variants of modernist structures of thought. And I'm simplifying the ontological critique here. Modernist structures of thought, though different on the surface, share the same underlying metaphysical signature. That is the same technological metaphysics of modernity, or what technically we might call the apparatus. This modern metaphysical ethos, this apparatus in which we are all captured, is nothing but the pure embodiment of a will to power. Modernity's fundamental mode of being is predicated around order, precision, calculation, management, and security. And all these become key elements of a very distinctive way, a very distinctive modern way of knowing and living in the world. Modernity fundamentally foregrounds a very purely instrumental and economic and technological understanding of the way of being and being in the world. Such an understanding leads us to think of all beings, including human beings, but especially animals and the natural environment, as composed of entities lacking any meaning other than as resource for relentless optimization, efficiency, and calculation. Progress has become growth for growth's sake. In a word, life itself has become, political life has become cancer. And this is really, I think, where Yosin comes in. It's a very preliminary thought, and we need a lot more testing in various labs, but I think if I could be so bold that Yosin is a cure, a potential cure for this cancer at the global, political, and spiritual levels. Yosin is a form of art, a practice. It's not an ideology or a dogma. A practice of thoughtful, critical, ethical self-cultivation in relationship to an ethos. Yosin, therefore, is like love itself. It cannot be measured, cannot be quantified, cannot be held tightly. It is a call to a task. It is the assumption of a responsibility. And what else is responsibility, responsibility, other than the ability or the potential to respond? And it is this ability, this potential that Habib's educational philosophy and this university is directed towards. It is a task and a challenge, a passion to understand the world without illusions and falsehoods, and only in this sense noble. But fundamentally, it encourages us wherever we can to orient and receive a world in crisis, to respond to it as best as we can, to respond to the tears, not just of humanity, but of Earth itself and all life on it, since we are nothing other than this form of life. At this point, I would like to invite our beloved president, who will give you a much more deeper understanding of this term. President Wasif Rizvi is a globally recognized visionary leader of the higher education enterprise. He's the closest thing we have to Dumbledore. So he has been known to cast a spell or two on people. He just has this magic about him. So without further ado, our president, patron of Yosin, Wasif Rizvi.
Note to self, we need to put a words limit on MC's opening address. Salam, adab. Welcome to Habib University's 8th Yosin Lecture. A special welcome to Jamila Habib, who is also representing our Honorable Chancellor Rafiq Habib, who regrettably couldn't join us due to some health concerns. We send our best wishes and du'as for RMH's health, inshallah. This is the first in-person Yosin lecture since 2019. So the last two that you listed, Noam Chomsky and Ashish Nandi, was online. As most of you may know, that Yosin title for this lecture series is drawn from Habib University's motto, which is قِيمَةُ كُلِّ إِمْرِي مَا يُحْسِنَهُ, a saying of Imam Ali, which means everyone's worth is in their yosin, as to what they do with excellence, with grace and beauty, and with goodness and service for others. It's hard to imagine a more appropriate speaker which reflects the spirit of yosin, especially the beauty part, than the globally eminent interdisciplinary figure among us, the one and only Azra Apa Raza. Since her middle name is a mystery, it's my first resolution today to adopt this ubiquitous Apa formally as Dr. Raza's middle name. So it's Azra Apa Raza. Azra Apa will be formally introduced by our distinguished MC. We refuse to call him anything else but that. Partly because she is undoubtedly my ustad, so I won't dare it. Shagird hain hum meer se ustad ke rasikh, ustadon ka ustad hai ustad hamara. And in somewhat nazuk mizaji, Apa is quite similar to Mir. If Rasik had uttered this share in front of Mir Saab, Probably you would have heard this in return. Ye fane ishq hai aave, ise teenat mein jiski ho. Ye fane ishq hai aave, use teenat mein jiski ho. Tu zahid peer nabalig hai beta, tujhko kya aave. So, I am a wizened version of Rasikh. No pressure, the exalted Najib. You have to do it. The other more serious reason is that I want to talk a bit about Habib University and our unique and inspiring mission. One of my mentors, John Hennessy, former president of Stanford University, shared with me personally some of the key aspects of the trade of being a university president. According to him, the president of a good, engaged, community-owned and celebrated university would never let an auditorium full of current and potential donors go home without hearing about how awesome we are. And we are indeed quite awesome. So, exhibit A of our awesomeness. During our research about higher education, while working on Habib project, we found a both distinguishing and common feature among all great institutions of higher learning. They're all disparate in their offering and foci, but all of them shared a deep sense of adherence to their core mission. Harvard has Veritas. Yale, that is paralyzed by their desire to have a one-up on Harvard. So it's Lux and Veritas. My second favorite actually is from MIT, which is Mans et Manus, mind and hands, two of the most creative faculty of human endowment. These succinct expressions of mission continue to shape the trajectory of these institutions. For Habib, we actually were truly fortunate to select Kimatu Kulli Imri Ma Yohsanahu. Passion, grace, excellence, respect, service, husn, hasan, ahsan, ahsan. But it's very hard to capture the majesty of hikmah in this saying. I'll just sort of give you a couple of commentaries, brief ones. The foundational literary theorist of Arabic language, Abu Uthman al-Jahiz, which lived around 200 Hijriah, whose book Al-Bayan wa At-Tabiyin, which means literally elegance and clarity, establishes the foundation of fasahat as a core principle of great Arabic literature, which means brief. He's mesmerized by this saying. This is 150 years before Sayyid Razi discovered it and put it in Nahj. So, pehle what Sayyid Razi said, yeh angrezi mein nahi bataya ja sakta. Qeemat kulli imri ma yuhsanu. Sayyid Razi kehte hain, yeh aisa anmol jumla hai ke na koi hakeemana baat iske wazan ki ho sakti hai, na koi jumla iske hum paya hai. Abu Usman Jahiz, jiski sabse mashhoor kitab yeh thi, jo maine bhi batai, Al-Bayan al-Batin, isko tamam salaf, yani masudi likhte hain ke عربی کا فصیح ترین قلمکار ہے وہ کہتا ہے اپنی کتاب کے بارے میں کہ اگر اس کتاب یعنی اس کتاب البیان والتبین میں اس ایک فقرے کے سوا کچھ بھی نہ ہوتا اگر صرف اس نے قیمت کل امری ما یحسن ہو لکھا ہوتا تو بھی ہم اس کتاب کو کافی و شافی مکتفی اور بے نیاز کر دینے والی کتاب پاتے بلکہ ہم اسے کفایت کی حد سے بھی بڑھ کر غایت و مراد پر منتج ہونے والی پاتے ہیں سب سے احسن کلام وہ ہے جس کا اختصار ہمیں کثرت و تفصیل سے بے نیاز کر دے اور اس کے معنی ظاہر میں اور باطن میں راستوں کو روشن کرنے والے ہوں Quite opposite to the ontologist. Right? Says that brevity and depth. اور پھر اس نے اپنا یہ آخر میں جو تمام دنیا میں مشہور ہے اس جملے کے آخر میں اس نے یہ تعریف لکھی کلام الامام امام الکلام امام کا کلام کلاموں کا امام ہے Our founding, own founding faculty member Noman Naqvi translated it actually very well Yosan is thoughtful self-cultivation. So that means it's a perennial process of cultivation. It's a verb. It's not a conclusion or a product. It's a way of being. So it's not a mere coincidence that the last two and today's speaker are an embodiment of Yosan's way of being. Noam Chomsky, whose anguish by the ravages of advanced and possibly terminal stage cancer of capitalism, and is also the leading commentator to inform us about it. Ashish Nandi, perhaps the most formidable thinker in highlighting the origins of this cancer, horrific colonial epistemicide and ensuing devastation of our entire cognition. And now Dr. Azra Raza, taking on the cancer of literally cancer. All three, Noam Chomsky, Ashish Nandi, and Dr. Azra Raza, do what they do, fully knowing Sauda jo bekhabar hai, wahi yaan kar hai aish. Mushkil bahut hai unki, jo rakhte hai aagahi. But the adherents of Yosan are not fearful of this aagahi, this no bull. Ragon mein daudne phirne ke hum nahi qayal. Jab aank si se na tapka, to phir lahu kya hai? The Aagahi, which is inspired among Habib students while going through various stages of Habib curriculum, is something daunting and overwhelming. But amazing discourses like which we hosted a few days ago at PHSC, and of course today, allow us to feel that this movement of cultivation, grace, cultivation of grace in an ugly world, is more widespread than we sometimes realize. It's a gift to have Azra Apa here, to give us profound reassurance of the presence of this grace and beauty. Reading Azra Apa's book, The First Cell, one experiences this aankh ka lahu of undeterred passion in confronting an unforgiving and horrific malady. How very Yosan of you. Adab Azra Apa, and welcome to Habib University.
I will say a few formal things as an introduction to those who don't know Dr. Azra Apa Raza. Is the Chun Soon Shiong, I'm not sure if I got that correct, the Chan Soon Shiong Professor of Medicine and Clinical Director of the Edward P. Evans Foundation MDS Center at Columbia University, New York. She is a practicing oncologist, and she sees 30 to 40 cancer patients weekly. So, you know, like perpetually apto on kolhenji. She directs a basic cancer research lab with hundreds of original publications in high-profile journals. She has worked on various cutting-edge research programs with people at the absolute highest level, including with American President Bill Clinton, designing breakthrough developments in science and technology, and with Vice President on the Cancer Moonshot Initiative. Her latest book, The First Cell, and the Human Cost of Pursuing Cancer to the Last, was published in October 29 and won numerous awards. She has co-authored with Sara Suleri Goodyear a translation and interpretation of Ghalib's Epistemologies of Elegance. She is convinced that the best way to tame the savageness of man and make gentle the life of this world, quote from her, is by promoting the grand achievements of humanity in science, art, and literature. She is especially moved by fine poetry. And to just extend very briefly the series of intimate connections I was talking about, my own brother oncologist happens to be very, very good friends with our dear speaker today. And when I told him I had this opportunity to MC, he said, Najib, she is one of the finest human beings and one of the most outstanding lecturers you'll have ever heard. So without that, confronting with passion the conundrum of life.
Adabers. There are 1,000 meanings and contexts that can be assigned to the word Yosan. But the simplest one is this. What you do it well. You do it beautifully. Such is my challenge today. I must do justice to the sublime concept of Yosin, naturally, it's made me nervous. Thinking about it reminded me of the time when some years ago I was having a telephone conversation with the great Urdu writer Qurratul Ain Haider, Aini Apa to me, and she recounted a wonderful incident about another great Urdu writer, Ismat Chughtai. Apparently, once, Ismat Apa tried to give some money to her dhobi. And the dhobi's response was, "What is it for?" She said, "What do you mean, what is it for? Go buy some toys for your children." And his response was, "Pain." And pain is a Purbi version of phir, meaning then what? She said, "What do you mean, pain? Go buy some new clothes for your wife." He said, "Pain." And so every time she offered something else he could do with the money, his response was, "And then what?" And so this back and forth continued for a while, and Aini Apa says, "So Azra Begum, this is what life is all about. A never-ending series of pain. I got the Sahitya Academy Fellowship, pain. I got the Bharatiya Gyan Peeth Award, pain. Tomorrow I get the Nobel Prize, pain." Ismat Apa's dhobi posed a fundamental existential question, the waiting for Godot kind of question that Samuel Beckett asks, and the same one that our two great writers spent their lifetimes addressing extensively in their masterful works. I urge all of you, especially the young people today, to please reread them again and again. In fact, Aini Apa began asking this question when she was barely 19 years old in her book, Mere Bhi Sanam Khane. When I read her book as a teenager, I was very struck by one sentence, which is exactly poses this question. Imagine, Qurratul Ain Haider is only 19 years old when she asks this question. And those lines have stayed with me for all of these years. Chal ye maan liya ke hamari zindagi ludakti, ludkati, marti, marti, kabhi us maqam par pahunch jaye, jahan pe Banta Singh Fazal Dad Khan ke pet mein chura ghonpne se apne ko rok leta hai. Aur Israel aur Filistiniyon ki jang khatam ho jati hai. Aur puri dunya mein amn aur aman hi aa jata hai. To is sari cheezon se Rakhshanda Begum ki zindagi mein kya farq padega? Kuch bhi nahi. Kuch bhi nahi. Essentially, all great works of art revolve around similar themes. Here is the great American black author and activist James Baldwin, who clarifies our shared destiny with a startling eloquence. I quote, "Life is tragic simply because the earth turns and the sun inexorably rises and sets, and one day for each of us, the sun will set for the final time. Perhaps the whole root of our trouble is that we will sacrifice all the beauty of our lives, will imprison ourselves in totems, taboos, crosses, mosques, races, armies, flags, nations, in order to deny the fact of death, which is the only fact we have. It seems to me that one ought to rejoice in the fact of death. In fact, ought to earn one's death by confronting with passion the conundrums of life." It is the small beacon in the terrifying darkness from which we come and to which we shall return. One must negotiate this passage as nobly as possible for the sake of those who are coming after us. End of quotation. Our great classics, and especially our poets, agree with Baldwin in concluding that the only solution to our existential angst lies in confronting with passion the conundrum of life. In one breathtakingly beautiful ghazal, Faiz Ahmed Faiz takes us through what such a journey will look like. It is a call to action, to unconditionally give our all to the quest, to expect nothing in return, no rewards, to anticipate, in fact, crushing disappointments, and yet to continue to live, to err, to fall, to triumph, to recreate life out of life. Kis harf pe tune gosha-e lab ae jaan-e-jahan ghammaz kiya aelan-e-junoon dilwalon ne abke bahazar andaaz kiya sau paikaan the paivast-e-gulu jab chhedi shauk ki leh humne sau teer tarazu the dil mein jab humne raqs aagaaz kiya be-hirs-o-havas be-khauf-o-khatar is haath mein sar is kaf pe jigar یوں کوئے سنم میں وقت سفر نظارہ بام ناز کیا اور جس خاک میں مل کر خاک ہوئے وہ سرمے جس خاک میں مل کر خاک ہوئے وہ سرمے چشم خلق بنے جس خار پہ ہم نے خون چھڑکا ہم رنگ گلے تن ناز کیا اور لو وصل کی ساعت آ پہنچی پھر حکم حضوری پر ہم نے آنکھوں کے دریچے بند کیے اور سینے کا در باز کیا Let me begin the serious lecture by showing my deepest gratitude first to the House of Habib, whose representatives, Jamila Habib, Munize Habib, and I hope the younger Habibs are in the audience, so grateful for the nobility of your gesture in making sure that we impart the best of knowledge available anywhere in the world within this institution to the young people. Congratulations. Truly an honor for me to be here, to be speaking to you today. And of course, my second word of gratitude has to go to Pakistan and to Karachi especially. Qudrat ne sikhai thi humko uftad yahan, parwaz yahan, gaye the wafa ke geet yahan, chheda tha junoon ka saaz yahan. And then I need to acknowledge my gratitude, my deepest thanks to the country where I live and have lived for the last 43 years, the United States of America. A country where, yes, wealth, power, celebrity are very much acknowledged and sought after, but it is also a country that provides you with a level playing field. And that's the beauty of America. That a chit of a brown female like me can get up from Karachi, Pakistan, and go to the United States and compete with the most well-educated, well-schooled researchers, and on the basis of merit alone, able to receive grants and support exactly in the same way as anyone born and raised in the country. I salute the United States. And I want to dedicate this talk to my best teacher, who was also my best friend, Professor Sara Suleri Goodyear. I took this picture on my terrace back in Massachusetts while we were practically joined by the hip doing our work on the Ghalib book. And today I want you to note this beautiful jacket that I'm wearing belongs to Sara Suleri and her younger sister, Tilat, who I adore, and I just visited in Vancouver a few weeks ago. She gave it to me. So in Sara's honor, I am dedicating the talk to her and wearing her own jacket to do this. And of course, the entire basis of this Yosin lecture is so beautifully described by both Najib and then Wasif, is embodied in these two lines. The fruit of a good action must be like its root. How gorgeous is this? The ends do not justify the means. Every step has to be beautiful in your life, because the only Zen you will find on the top of the mountain is the Zen you brought with yourself. And no one else could have said this profound thing except, of course, the Imam, Ali ibn Abi Talib. Here's something that fascinated me as I read more and more into the sciences as a teenager. That within our body, we give birth to literally a new life form that can live forever. And it occurred to me that if we can unlock the secret of aging, if we can unlock the secret of cancer, we can unlock the secret of aging and live forever. This was my first intellectual fascination with cancer. How is it possible that a cell within us can live forever? And the second thing that shocked me was that, you know, we have rules in the body. Liver cells stay in the liver. Cells born in the ovaries stay in the ovary. But only in one disease, they literally walk out of the organs of origin. How is that possible? How is cancer becoming mobile? These were the two questions that forced me to start thinking seriously about oncology even before I had joined medical school. But then, of course, the reason for doing becomes the passion for being, which is the only way, is when the intellectual challenge is combined to an emotional investment. And for me, that came when at Dow Medical College, as a third year student, I saw my first cancer patient, and it moved me so much that I knew the rest of my life must be spent in trying to reduce the suffering of these individuals. And that has been my quest for all of these years. And I began my journey at Roswell Park Cancer Institute in 1977. I walked in as a 20-something. I won't say exactly what. I don't want you to calculate my age. I walked into, within 2 weeks of landing in Buffalo, New York, I was so anxious that somebody else might cure cancer. I need to start immediately. And what I saw written on the wall of this great institution was, if I had a choice between a walk on the moon and saving one life from cancer, I would never look at the moon again. Two things struck me about this saying. One is that this is exactly what I had wanted to do. I knew I was in the right place. Wow, I had arrived. But the second thing that struck me was that only in a country like America can you dream even of something like walking on the moon, because they have, through their own merit and hard work, reached a position where they can actually ask questions of this nature. And then they're not afraid of it. Plus, they have developed the affluence to support this kind of work. And the brain drain that we blame them for actually is being put to very good use, because they're the ones who provide the opportunity and the resources which are so essential for any kind of research. And so I was very moved by this and immediately decided that this is where I'm going to do my oncology training. And that's exactly what I did. So moving on, I started my work in researching and treating patients with acute myeloid leukemia, a particularly deadly form of blood bone marrow cancer. But within a few years, it was clear to me that in my lifetime, this disease will not be cured. Why? Because it's so difficult. And unfortunately, I was right, because I am today using the same exact treatment I was using in 1970s for these patients. We have not made one iota of progress in treating these patients. 7 and 3 is 7 days of one chemotherapy, 3 days of another. That was the standard first-line treatment for acute myeloid leukemia in 1977. That is what it is today in 2023. It is an embarrassment. 5-year survival for these individuals in 77 was 26%. Do you know what it is today, for which we are patting ourselves on the back and prancing on the stages of international conferences, giving each other gold medals and proclaiming success from rooftops? This is what it is, 28.5%. What is this supposed to mean? Yes, the only way to deal with this issue is find cancer before it finds us, because by the time this end stage monstrosity which we diagnose has arrived, it's too late. So I immediately resolved back then that I'm going to work hard to find cancer at its first cell stage. But how do you find leukemia early? Because by the time, or any cancer, by the time you have even a small tumor that appears in the body, there are hundreds of millions of cells. How do you find the first cell? Well, it occurred to me we have to find cancer in people who are at high risk of developing the disease and start following them till they develop it, and then we find the first cell. That was a very simplistic idea, but it has persisted with me. Who is at high risk of developing acute leukemia? I asked myself. Well, there are these diseases called myelodysplastic syndromes, MDS. And so back, way back in 1980s, I decided that while studying and treating acute leukemia, I will also focus on people with pre-leukemia or MDS and follow the trajectory of their natural history of their disease as it develops into acute leukemia and find at least the first leukemia cell in these patients. And so we could intercept and prevent the appearance of this disease. So problem is, if I had gone to school in America, at this point, my next step would have been to make a mouse model of the disease and start studying it. And this is where being from another country, being an immigrant, helped me, because I could think sort of naively enough to say, why should I study a model? And why? What struck me was the treachery of images that presented, or you will recognize this picture immediately, but it's an artist that I have greatly admired for the longest of time, René Magritte, whose famous painting is this. The title of this painting is, "This is not a pipe." Well, it looks like a pipe, doesn't it? But the title is, "This is not a pipe," for the simple reason that you can't pick it up and smoke it. That's it. It's a model of a pipe. And this is what struck me, that studying animals to try and find cure for cancer in humans is literally doing this. In fact, the best model of a cat is another cat, preferably the same one. And this is what my favorite cybernetics founder, Norbert Wiener, said back in the 40s. But why study a model at all? I don't understand it. And my whole book is a long lamentation about just this problem. Many scientists will stop me and say, "No, Azra, you don't understand. We have really, by studying models, we can't do things to humans that we can do to animals. We can give them cancer, 10 of them, kill them, study them. We have understood the biology of cancer much better." I stop them and say, "No, do not say that to me. Had you understood the biology of cancer, you would have cured it. What you've understood is the biology of something artificial you have created in a petri dish or in a model. That's why it is not ending up in helping our patients as much as this should. And so, of course, the idea is that we should monitor individuals at high risk of cancer, and to cure human cancer, we must study human samples. And so back in 1984, I started simply collecting bone marrows, blood, saliva, biopsies, all kinds of samples I could get in humans, and just putting them in my freezers. Today, I have collected more than 60,000 human samples from thousands of patients who have been longitudinally studied, and not a single cell in this tissue repository comes from another physician. I've collected these tissues myself. You know how? Because to this day, I work like a medical student. I do my own bone marrow biopsies to this day. Just before coming here, I had a full clinic where I did biopsies on 8 patients. I'm drawing their bloods. I'm doing all this myself, but never giving up on storing the samples and studying them repeatedly. I think this is the most important tissue repository in the country that has been, in the world, I would say, that has been collected by a single physician. People are waking up now to start tissue repositories. I've been doing this since 1984, and these samples are serially obtained on the patients as they go from pre-leukemia to developing leukemia, so that we understand what is responsible for that phase transition from pre to the frankly leukemic phase. So that is the only way to find the first cell. Let me now begin this middle of the talk by giving you an example of the case of Andrew. In July of 2016, he developed tingling in his right arm. He started to exercise more. Weakness developed and he was taken to the emergency room. He was quadriplegic within hours, which means both his arms and legs became paralyzed within hours of appearing in the emergency room. The neurosurgeons could remove only 90% of the large glioblastoma multiforme, one of the most malevolent, malignant tumors known to mankind, a brain tumor. Now, because the doctors had to leave behind 10% of the tumor, from this moment on, all his treating oncologists, which included me, knew that his prognosis was hopeless. No matter what we did, we will not add one day of survival to this patient. Yet, what followed? What followed is extensive surgeries, aggressive chemo, radiation, immune manipulation, more chemo, more immune manipulation, more radiation, placements of shunts. He suffered unbearable toxicities. The tumors continued to grow. Alas, we lost Andrew in 2017, 16 months from diagnosis. He was 23 years old. We failed Andrew. How badly we failed this boy. He had the most painful death imaginable. Why is this patient so important to me? Because Andrew was my daughter Sheherzad's best friend. He was not her boyfriend. Our Andrew was gay. But there are parents in this room. Friends of your children are in and out of your house all the time since they're little kids. Andrew is like a family member. Do you know how many nights I got a call from Sheherzad sitting by his side at the cancer center saying, "Mommy, you're supposed to help cancer patients. You're not helping Andrew." The last few weeks of his life as he was dying, they brought him what is called a DNR form, do not resuscitate, to sign. He sent them away, "I'm not signing this." That night, when his father came to spend the night with him, he called the nurses back and said, bring the form back. He said, I will sign it now. My mother was with me all day. I couldn't sign it in front of her. She wouldn't be able to take it. At 22 years of age, he's protecting his mother. Was honesty a choice? What was the choice we were giving to Elena, Andrew's mother, and to Andrew? Die of cancer or die of the treatment we'll give you? Why are these the only choices, even today? Sure, we cure 60% of cancers we diagnose today, absolutely. But what are we curing them with? The same slash, poison, and burn. So where have trillions of dollars of research gone? Why don't we have magical new treatments for them? Even the 60% we are curing, what they have to go through belongs in the Paleolithic era, belongs to the caveman. Women's breasts are being slashed the same way they were hundreds of years ago. Why haven't we made improvements, is my question. And the 40% we are not curing, their problem is they were diagnosed at an advanced stage and their outcome is no better than it was in 1930s. Look at this graph. I couldn't make up these statistics. In 2023, the age-adjusted mortality from cancer is the same that it was in 1930. Sure, there's an incline and a decline, and there is a 1% decline in mortality every year, but that is because of anti-smoking and anti-obesity campaigns and early detection, not because we have come up with fantastic new treatments. Yes, there have been some great advances like immune therapies, CAR T cells, but they are good for like 10,000 people at most out of 2 million new cases a year. And even those cost so much money that can only be given to in a few countries. This is not the solution for cancer. And this is why, this is my cry of lamentation. Of course, even in America. Because I have called out about the truth of behind all this progress we are making. For example, my colleague, my best friend, Siddharth Mukherjee, wrote a fantastic Pulitzer Prize-winning book called The Emperor of All Maladies. And he was my first interlocutor at the book launch, and his first question to me was, so Azra, basically what you are saying is that the emperor has no clothes? I said, yes, that's exactly what I'm saying. So the way I'm treated right now in the oncology world is as if I have written the satanic verses of medicine. But you'll see what I mean by persisting in my quest. So what are the causes of cancer? Basically, hereditary susceptibility to cancer, infections have been associated with cancer, smoking, exposure to toxins. But most of the time, we think that as a cell divides into two cells, there are DNA copying errors, and a DNA copying error is called a mutation. So as cells divide, they pick up new mutations, and by the time we are older, we have too many mutations. For example, here's a completely normal cell. As it divides into two, it picks up a mutation because the DNA polymerase made an error. But each time this cell divides, it picks up more mutations. So you see what happens is that by the time we are diagnosing cancer, every cell has gazillions of mutations in it. And yet the treatment we are developing by studying mouse models is against one mutation. How is that possible? It's not going to work. The only way that kind of treatment, one against one mutation, will work is not going to be up there, but it's going to be down here when there was one mutation, which means early detection, which means the same treatments that are failing today, if applied here, will work much better. That's the simplest way I can explain this to you, because this is a Darwinian tree that he drew with his own hands for describing evolution by natural selection, but I borrowed it to describe evolution of cancer. This is exactly how it happens. So my major conclusions is that the genetic mutation model of cancer has not generally helped develop curative treatments, except in one case of cancer, chronic myeloid leukemia, out of 200 types of cancers, 199 have not responded to this approach. So the same treatment will work better if it's applied early. Well, cancer is hardly, in my opinion, a result of random mutations. So how does cancer, in my opinion, appears? I think it's a response to stress. I don't mean mental stress, though mental stress is important, but stress in an organ. For example, stress of infections, toxins, aging. Oh, aging is the worst stress possible on the organs, because lots of cells are dying, they are releasing debris which collects and which poisons the whole environment in which cells are supposed to be proliferating. And so cells in the organ receive the signal fight or flight. The environment is so poisonous that either you're going to develop a strategy to survive or you're going to die. And in developing a survival strategy, this is how cells can develop into becoming immortalized. They ignore everything then. They can ignore the growth inhibitory signals. And so my question was, how can we study this kind of stress in my lab? Well, producing stress in the lab using CRISPR-caused mutations, giving cells chemotherapy, producing hypoxia, starving the cells, all this produces stress, and so I started to study the response of stress. I know this is a bit scientific, but please just be with me, and I'm sure you'll follow me through. So in my lab, we started growing, these are leukemia cells happily growing in a dish. Once we exposed them to, let's say, the CRISPR-caused mutations, I saw something very bizarre, which is the appearance of these large cells suddenly, giant cells. Or we were happily growing cells, leukemia cells, when we gave them chemotherapy, we saw the same thing, appearance of these giant cells. And when we looked at them closely, so in my lab, we do a lot of time-lapse photography. So we fixated the lens of our camera onto one large cell and followed it. Nothing happened to it for 3 days. And then suddenly, do you see, the same cell started giving birth to little cells. It's like literally cancer is being born out of a mother cell. Now we have caught this phenomenon over and over. It is named somatic cell pregnancy. And over you can see these giant cells giving birth, literally pinching out of the giant cell. You see these tiny little cells. Here is another picture showing the same. Here is one giant cell. And I've of course published all this, giving birth to one giant cell. And then few weeks later, the large cells disappear. All you see are the small cells. And this is when we diagnose cancer. In other words, all our research has been focused on this. But these are the last cells. The first cell we have missed completely in all these years. Why? Because the way to make a model of cancer in animals is you take a tumor from a patient, you kill the mouse's immune system and put this tumor in the mouse and it starts growing there. And then but you already have cancer then. You've taken a cancer cell and put it in there. So all you see is divisions of those small cells. They don't show any large cell. And so what are these giant cells? No one is talking about them. Actually, a lot of people are talking about them since 1856. And these are called polyploid giant cancer cells. They're extremely rare once cancer has fully organized and established itself. You don't find them. But what I did is, I did something clever, and I'll show you, which helped me find these. I thought we should be able to capture them from the blood. And so back, it occurred to me that they're such large cells, we should literally use a coffee filter-like technology. If we pass blood through a filter, the large cells will get trapped, the blood cells will go through, and that would be one way to catch them. And so in 2015, 8 years ago now, I put a filtration device in my lab. It's called ISET, isolation by size of epithelial tumors, working with my French colleague Patrizia Patrilini, another brilliant scientist. And so we started literally filtering people's patients' blood. So you take 10 cc's of blood and you pass it through this filter here. And what you began to see is these giant cells. You see how pregnant this cell looks with all the babies inside it and giving birth. And I've caught this phenomenon in hundreds and hundreds of patients now. You see this giant cell with all the babies. Every time you're able to find, this is to me the first cell. This is not from tissue culture cell lines. This is not from animal models. This is actually from patients. And so in solid tumors, more than 5,000 patients studied so far, this is the size of a white blood cell in the blood. And in the blood are captured these. Look at the comparison. How giant and bizarrely shaped are these first cells that you can capture from the blood. These are called CAMLs, cancer-associated macrophage-like cells, and in all kinds of common cancers, breast, prostate, they've been found. I don't want to belabor the point, but here's something important for you to see. Changes after treatment in the number of giant cells, their size, predict survival. How? Well, if there's a cancer patient, you provide the best available therapies to the patient. Let's say somebody has pancreatic cancer or lung cancer. You treat them as best as you can. After that, you simply, after all the treatment is done, take 10 cc's of blood and filter it and look for the presence of giant cells. If you find no giant cells, there is no relapse. It's a straight line of survival. Even if you find one giant cell, your patients start to relapse. In other words, post-treatment presence of these giant cells can predict for survival. This is a very important statement. So, this is my new model of cancer. Stress, under stress, one cell will literally just fuse with another cell. And that fusion is what causes the cell to double in size. And each time it divides within the cell, the size keeps increasing. How is that helpful? Because when cells are stressed and they are getting the signal, you will die unless you get a strategy. They have no time to make mutations and develop a new strategy. No, one thing they can do is immediately, boom, just fuse. Cooperation rather than competition always wins. By fusing with each other, they immediately double the number of every gene they need, you see? So it makes total sense. But then this cell becomes some genomic re-engineering occurs as the two cells fuse together. And I think of it like an egg and a sperm that come together to form a zygote and then literally gives birth to all the cells that form the human embryo and a human baby. It's always the fusion of two cells, and cancer is the birth of a new life form within our body, which is also resulting from the fusion of two cells. So in other words, what I'm saying to you is that the first cell is two cells. Okay, this is what happens. With time, it births. And I showed you earlier the videos of these things, that they actually give birth to cancer cell. This is the mother cell, the first cell. When we come in with treatment, it only ends up killing the small cancer cells. It doesn't affect the mother cell, the giant cell, because the reason for coming into existence of the giant cell is to withstand stress. It's not going to be killed by chemotherapy. It will survive. And with time, that is what is going to cause recurrence. And so a new treatment immediately occurred to me, that if we target and take out this giant cell, for example, here is a cell let's say a liver cell, which is expressing an antigen A. It fuses not with another liver cell, but fuses instead with a blood cell, which was expressing antigen B. Antigen means something sticking out of its surface. So instead of two liver cells fusing, actually it's a liver cell that is fusing with a blood cell. And that fusion then results in this giant cell expressing now a liver cell marker and a blood marker. These two should never occur on a normal cell. So this makes the giant cell unique, that it has a blood marker and its tissue of origin marker. And this can serve as a target, a new target. So for example, we have made an antibody that contains within it a little protein that is inside a cage. So antibody will bind to the antigen A, nothing will happen. An antibody we made, which we gave it a key. So this is a cage in which the protein is there. This is a key. Nothing happens to this cell, nothing happens. But when there is a giant cell with both the things together, the key will open the lock. And what will that do? That will stick out this arm here. And that is what will catch a circulating T cell, immune cell, from the patient's own blood, bring it and boom, take the cell out. This is what we are developing to take out the giant cell. And so, full disclosure, thank you. I am living in a capitalist country, and when I filed for my patent for this, sent my invention report, the Columbia University Technology Ventures office got very excited and said, Dr. Raza, the kind of work you're doing, you cannot support it with grants alone, because grants alone bring few million dollars a year. They said, no, you need hundreds of millions of dollars now. So the only way to do that is if you promise to make for the people giving you hundreds of millions, billions of dollars, which means you need to make a company. So at this ripe old age, I finally was forced into making a company. I'm the founder of the first cell therapeutics. And and I'd like to say something here that has moved me deeply. Three wealthy Pakistanis in America offered me $50 million with no strings attached. No strings attached. And they said, Azra Appa, we are giving it to you, even if you don't cure cancer, just because you are asking. Or you are Azra Appa. I was so moved by this, honestly. The love that I received from Pakistanis is unbelievable. I was very moved, but I had to say no to them because 50 million, unfortunately, is not enough. The kind of work requires hundreds of millions of dollars because I need to bring this technology to the bedside. I'm not treating mice and petri dishes. I have to treat humans because we don't know. This is sounds like a perfect story. But when I have the tri-specific antibody that I'm making, so the one arm binds to antigen A, the second arm binds to antigen B on the cell, and the third arm sticks out and catches a circulating immune cell to bring it and kill it. That's a technological feat which my lab has amazing number of PhD scientists working full time on developing this, and it has been a while, but we keep running into technical problems. But they're technical problems. I'm confident we'll solve them. It's just taking us a little time. But even if we get the perfect product, once we give it to patients, we have no idea what it's going to do because it's an unknown thing. And that is what requires first so much money to go into this and then hundreds of millions to actually do a clinical trial. A clinical trial takes up to $1 billion. And that is why it's so horrible that 95% of experimental trials today in America and cancer fail. And imagine a venture, an enterprise, where the failure rate is 95%. And the 5% that succeed, in my opinion, should have failed because they improve survival by a couple of months for 30% patients. And yet people are willing to put in hundreds of millions of dollars because if one of them succeeds, they're going to make billions. And so with that in mind, I said no to my beautiful Pakistani colleagues, but then thankfully I have received the funding that I was looking for. And we are going full speed ahead, and perhaps Wasif will be kind enough to invite me once again so I can report on my progress to you. But thank you. Let me end by giving my major conclusions from this talk today is that cancer is a response to stress. The first cell, maybe two cells, fuse to double their ability to fight stress. Giant fused cells captured in the blood of liquid tumors, as well as 20 of the most common solid tumors that have been studied. Can removing giant cells improve survival of cancer patients? I'm proposing a two-step approach. First, we kill the cancer that we see. Giant cells will survive. Now we come in with the antibody that I'm developing, which will be completely non-toxic because it's only going to remove a few giant cells. So this two-step approach. It occurred to me, why should I be the only one saying this? So I started calling my colleagues across the country and saying to them, here is my proposal, that we should go find the first cell and take it out. Either you point out the fatal flaw in my argument or join the revolution. Do you know that not one individual refused me? And so I created an oncology think tank some years ago. 30 leaders from the top institutions in America, Columbia, MD Anderson, Harvard, Dana-Farber's, the Harvard Cancer Institute, leaders from University of Chicago, everybody has joined me in the oncology think tank. Thank you. Leaders of large industries and pharmaceuticals who are interested in early detection joined me. We held 17 two-hour-long meetings. You don't know what it means to have institutional leaders like from the universities that I have, because every one of them is convinced that they are halfway to pick up their Nobel Prize already. So it's very hard to get them together, and I held 17 meetings with them, and we published an opinion paper which was published in Scientific American. I'm the lead author with 30 co-authors following me from all these institutions. And I was lucky enough, as soon, in fact, the day before she took the oath of office, Dr. Monica Bertagnoli, the new director of the National Institute of Health, was sitting in the conference where I was giving the keynote address, and I presented my assault on the field to her and told her that this is what we are doing is not fair to patients right now, that we are hurting them. Even if we are curing them, we are hurting them on the way, and that we need to do better. And I presented basically the talk you heard today. After the talk, she came and hugged me and she said, Dr. Raza, you are the exact kind of researcher I need. So I'm very pleased that I have Dr. Bertagnoli's support. So our idea is find cancer before it finds us, find a group of people who are at high risk of developing cancer. And one group is, do you know that 1 in 5 new cancers appear in a cancer survivor? I'm sure there are many people in the room here or some who have had cancer, who are cancer survivors. Do not get nervous because your individual risk is slightly higher of getting another cancer. It happened to my husband at 34, he had one cancer. He underwent horrible treatments, was cured. At 57, he got a completely new, different kind of cancer in the prime of his life. He died a tormented death. So a second cancer can happen most. When it happens, then 20% of new cases, that's a lot, 1 in 5, 20% happen in a cancer survivor. And so, just do the math. If there's 1.9 million cancer cases diagnosed this year, 400,000 will occur in a cancer survivor. So I created the first cell center for cancer survivors at Columbia University with all these institutions participating with me, where we are collecting blood, saliva, urine, feces, hair and nails every 6 months, 5 to 10 cancer survivors per day at Columbia University. I've already done the pilot of 500 cases. Now it will be extended to the other universities, and within 2 years, we should have enough samples to see who develops cancer and have we trapped the first cell in them or not. And then that's when I hope that my company's product will be ready to take out the first cell. So this is a journey which lifestyle changes. If you find cancer early enough, that's where things like exercising, dieting, eating better, all these things will matter. But the problem is we start doing those things when cancer is already in its full-fledged form, and that's not when it's going to work. And so let me end by coming back to Andrew. You know, his mother Elena called me recently, and she said, Azra, now my best friend has the exact same kind of brain tumor, glioblastoma multiforme stage 4, just like Andrew. And then she said to me, but you know what? I said to her, it's been 6 years since our Andrew died. I'm sure Azra has found a cure for it by now. How ashamed I felt. How ashamed. How embarrassed are we in front of Elena? I want us to come back to Elena, come back to Andrew, because this is not about personal aggrandizement at all. This is not about getting another grant or publishing another paper in Nature. This is about the Andrews of this world. Let me end by showing you a 2-minute video that Andrew's sister, Kat, made. She was only 2 years older than Andrew, so when she made it, she was 25 years. How many Andrews have to die? Let's just watch this 2-minute video as we end.
New York is in New York without you, love. So far in a few blocks to be so low. And if I call you from First Avenue, we're the only in the city who can handle me. New love wasn't true love, back to you, love. So much for a home run with some blue blood. If I
the meaning of the word Yosin. what you do, you should try to do it well. You should try to do it beautifully. I set out to cure cancer. I have not done it. The only consolation I have is that I did it with passion. Be hirso havas, be khauf o khatar, is haath mein sar, is kaf pe jigar, yun kuwe sanam mein waqt-e safar, nazare baame naaz kiya.
Thank you.
I'm going to invite Dr. Vasif Rizvi, our president, to join Azra Apa on the stage. Thank you for that absolutely scintillating talk, just raw, inspirational, honest, and incredibly inspiring. So I'm sure there are lots of questions from the audience, but we'll begin the conversation with between
Adab again. I have the unenviable task of expounding and talking about what was perhaps the most self-comprehensive lecture that at least one of the most ones that I have ever had the privilege of listening. Lekin chunke Azra Apa jo hain ye ek rare treat hain Karachi ke liye. तो ये हम सबको भी मौका है इनसे कुछ गुफ्तगू करने का बिकॉज द ओनली रेफरेंस दैट आई कुड फाइंड टू स्टार्ट दिस कॉन्वर्सेशन विद हर विल बी अ वन अप ऑन फैज इट विल बी गालिब सो इट्स एक्चुअली इज व्हेन आई वाज लिसनिंग टू दिस स्लैश बर्न poison so ye sher hasbehal hai it's actually basically captures your state as well ghalib ki badi mashhoor ghazal hai beqadr zarf hai saqi khumar tashna kami bhi jo tu daryaye main hai to main hu khumiyaza sahil ka iska ek sher hai which is you sarapa rehne ishq so obviously, ishq is impossible to translate. A poor, impoverished translation would be passion. Sarapa rehne ishq wa nagzir ulfat hasti. So, ye jo paradox hai, aapka sara sarapa jo hai is held hostage by this passion. Sarapa rehne ishq wa nagzir ulfat hasti. Lekin pragmatic, you have some sense of going on and preservation. Sarapa rehne ishq wa nagazir ulfat hasti, a paradox is captured in the next line, which agar aap log thodi si tawajjo dein, itna mushkil nahi hai. Sarapa rehne ishq wa nagazir ulfat hasti, ibadat barq ki karta hoon, aur afsos hasil ka. Ke ye aap ne ibadat ka jo intikhab kiya, it is actually is an obliterating sparring partner. That's cancer. So just want to understand ke, you know, how do you, in this paradoxical way, as Ghalib is suggesting, actually derive your energy, which seemingly is a very debilitating, deflating endeavor as well.
Thank you so much for your patience in listening to a very sort of scientific, basic research kind of talk. I wasn't sure that I would be able to do justice, but the fact that you're still here is a good sign. I'm very encouraged by that. Thank you so much. And thank you to Vasif for this gorgeous share. It's really beautiful, and it perfectly epitomizes not just my journey, but that of anyone who is with a quest like yourself also. I'm sure you can answer this question just as well as me. But I'd like to address one thing. A lot of people empathize with me and feel sorry for me because they say, Azra, how is it possible that you are seeing such seriously ill people all the time? Doesn't it depress you? And nothing could be farther from the truth than that. Because honestly, from the moment I walk into my clinic, it is like a love fest. From the staff that works there, to the patients who are there, to the families who come, to the doctors, my colleagues, my amazing scientific backers, unbelievable expressions of love, of human dignity, of grace. It is, I cannot tell you what a privilege it is to witness the nobility of their endurance. How these individuals rise to the challenge of so terrifying a disease with such great good humor, like Andrew protecting his mother, that she wouldn't be able to take it. Think of the profound nature of this gesture alone. And so, don't you agree with me that rather than feeling sorry for me, it is indeed one of the biggest honors of my life, and it is the answer to what Wasif is asking. That the answer is the humanity, the humans that I'm dealing with. It's so inspiring.
So, couple of points regarding the talk. Part of it is the epistemic inadequacy of the field. Okay, there it's wrong-headed, and you know, one can understand that the basic scientific principle that's been applied has proven to be horrifically wrong and inadequate. But how much of it is, again, this is Habib University, so I'm sure that many students, that the cynical aspect of the economy of cancer, which prevents investigations like yours, and have prevented investigations like yours, and have suppressed them, maybe misled them, maybe trivialized them, because it is a very lucrative business. So do you have any commentary on that?
I don't think it's just oncology that is being led by the business alone, business model. It's always, in every field, it's always the money trail. All I'm saying is that instead of going after the last cell, let's fix the goal to the first cell and then financially incentivize the goal. All the people who are studying the last cell will make a 180-degree turn and come to the first cell, including the largest industries. Because you know how I am able to convince the companies and industries and the top leaders in the industry who joined my quest, as I just showed you. Because I said to them that right now you are going after 2 million new cancer patients a year. But if you start studying people at high risk of cancer, you will have 300 million people. The entire country will be your customers. And of course, they'll find a way to make money. So I think that it's unfair in a way to say that it's the kind of incentives that exist for pharmaceutical companies or industry is driving the research. No, they are only doing it because researchers like myself, sitting in top class research institutions and Ivy League universities, we are the ones who are telling them to do this. If we start telling them, no, this is the wrong model, come to this, they will come and they will offer the money there because their stated goal is to make money, so we can't blame them.
Right.
The people to be blamed is ourselves, and that is why I want the academics to take the blinders off their eyes and actually see what you are doing to patients.
My last comment is actually, this is again a technical question. Do you think that, or are you working on detecting this giant cell in patients who are just high risk and never had cancer?
That is exactly the population I'm going after. And in fact, guess what? Now my new goal is, what is the stress that is causing the appearance of the first cell? We should prevent the appearance of the first cell even. How do you find that those stress markers? Again, from the blood. And this is where my tissue repository is coming in very handy. Because thousands of patients who had pre-leukemia and slowly developed leukemia, we have their all their samples available. Now that the technology is there to do genomics, proteomics, metabolomics, transcriptomics, glycomics, multiomics, the technology is available, we can do all this now and see what are the stress markers. And in the future, the way I'm imagining it, and I'm working with biomedical engineers at Columbia University to develop implantable devices, tiny little things that go under the skin, not even on top of the body, under the skin, that are constantly monitoring for the appearance of these stress markers in proteomics, genomics, transcriptomics, and sending the information onto a cloud over every individual's head that is constantly being dynamically analyzed by AI technology. And at the sign of the first disease-caused perturbation, sends a signal to the individual, which you can get on your cell phone, hey, stay away from that second helping of the dessert. You know, that's the kind of technology we are imagining in a very short period of time. I think this is the right time to be in cancer research. I wish I was 24 now. It's the end of my life, and as I said, if I see any of this happen actually in real time, it will be fantastic. But if I don't, then I want the young people in this room today to feel inspired that so much negative messages are being given all the time about the horrible state of the world and horrible climate and nuclear disasters and wars and this and that. But no, there is so much positive stuff going on in the world. AI is about to change everything that we do, and we can all basically commit ourselves to, again, confront with passion the conundrums of life and really try to rise above the kinds of negative information and fix our goals on positive things and start doing it today.
Right. On this uplifting point, I think we can open it. I don't know. I have not been told what is the timekeeping. But
we're doing good.
We're doing good. All right. So can we take a few questions, but be careful. अभी सवाल शुरू नहीं हुए तो आपके घंटे पहले से आपको उठाने का जवाब नहीं था ऑलराइट
आदाब अज़रा आपका गायबाना तारुफ है आपसे जब
ना भी तारुफ करा दीजिए आप
गुल जाफरी गुलेराना जाफरी जब अज़रा मोहिउद्दीन ने किताब आपकी लॉन्च हुई वो लेकर आपने उनको भेजी पाकिस्तान उन्होंने मुझे पकड़ाई पहले लफ्ज़ से और आखिरी लफ्ज़ तक एक मिनट को मैंने वो किताब नीचे नहीं रखी और आज का आपका लेक्चर जैसे लग रहा है कि इट वाज प्लेइंग दैट लाइक अ मूवी सो इट्स जस्ट अमेजिंग हाउ यू कंबाइंड योर सेल्फ दैट्स नोन टू द वर्ल्ड योर लिटरेरी योर ह्यूमर योर लिटरेचर आपकी उर्दू अंग्रेज़ी वाकयात शायरी गाने का शौक़ ज़ौक अज़रा ने बहुत वीडियोज़ वो दिखाई को आपने किताब में इस तरह कंबाइन किया कि मुझ जैसा ज़ीरो साइंस वाला आदमी आज के जो आपका लेक्चर है वो बिल्कुल खिल के सामने आ गया आई एम सरप्राइज आई डोंट नो हाउ मेनी हैव रेड इन दिस ऑडियंस द फर्स्ट सेल बट दैट इज़ ह्यूजली रिकमेंडेड एंड वासिफ भाई ये किताब इस तरह आप पढ़ेंगे जैसे आपने शायद दीवान गालिब पढ़ा होगा इस तरह कैंसर के उसमें और सियासत जो आपने उसमें आज एक्सप्लेन किए माई क्वेश्चन इज that Spanish or Latino American lobby of doctors that approached you and said, Dr. Raza, let us, why don't you share your cells and all? And then you said, point blank, no, that's not, I'm not going to have a, give you the free access to that. तो क्या उस वो सियासत जो थी जो आपने अभी मेंशन भी की द कैपिटलिस्ट सियासत ऑफ मनी हैज दैट बीन सॉर्ट ऑफ आंसर्ड बाय दीज ल्यूमिनरीज जॉइनिंग योर रिसर्च ऑफ दीज यूनिवर्सिटीज एंड दैट क्या आपने खोला है फर्स्ट सेल एफएसटी इज दैट अ प्रोग्रेस फ्रॉम दैट बुक इन विच यू हैव not lamented, but very craftily written that, you know. Aapne usme tanz bhi kiya hai aur usme wo bhi kiya hai. But bravo, and my dream come true that I'm face to face with you. Main New York mein mil nahi saki thi aapse.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Gul, first of all, I appreciate the fact that your hand was up for an hour. Jazbae be-ikhtiyare shauk dekha chahiye.
Thank you very much.
जज्बे बेख्तियारे शौक देखा चाहिए सीनाए शमशीर से बाहर है दिल शमशीर का आई एम सो ऑनर्ड बाय योर प्रेजेंस हियर गुल थैंक यू सो मच टू आंसर योर क्वेश्चन यस मे बी सम ऑफ द प्रॉब्लम्स आर सॉल्वड एज पीपल रियलाइज दैट आई एम अ क्रेडिबल पर्सन दैट एवरीथिंग आई हैव बीन सेइंग इज टर्निंग आउट टू बी ट्रू But then 1,000 new problems crop up every day. So life goes on like this. Yes, some old problems are resolved. Now new ones are facing me every single day. I am constantly on a quest to try and raise more and more money for the kinds of things I'm trying to do. And the idea is now I have that that pressure of not having enough time left. And so I feel like I have so little time, I have to do even more. And I have not done service to my patients that they deserved. I feel like a stupid failure every day of my life because of this. And I feel like I don't have years to look ahead. So somehow, the more money, the more resources I have, the faster I can do it. And that requires a lot of strength in numbers. As an individual, it may be possible for Van Gogh to stand and paint the starry night. Art is I, but science is we. It's an enterprise where you have to cooperate to be able to bring serious paradigm shifts. And for that reason, I would say that in answer to your question, that yes, where I am succeeding in some areas, in other areas, people are, as Wasif also hinted, constantly trying to suppress the work, the new stuff that is coming out. But hey, that's where my poetry helps me. Stand up and never give up.
Mera naam hai Munawwar Hamid Mangalwala. I'm an educationist by profession. And I will start my question with Iqbal ke sher ke saath main aapse question ask karunga. Ish qatil se bhi, maktool se bhi hamdardi. Maktool se hamdardi bhi. Ye bata kis se mohabbat ki jaza mangega. Sajdae khaliq ko bhi इबलीस से याराना भी हश्र में किससे अकीदत की सिला मांगेगा वी कैन अंडरस्टैंड द लव ऑफ डॉक्टर जेम्स ऑन वन हैंड कि वो कहते हैं कि मैं चांद पे नहीं जाऊंगा और मैं कैंसर के मरीज को बचाऊंगा आई अप्रिशिएट वी लव वी आर ऑन द सेम पेज बट ऑन द अदर हैंड इरेशनल थॉट विच हैज जस्ट कम बाय डॉक्टर बेंथेनन हु वॉज एन इंग्लिश इकोनमिस्ट वो मुझे ये कहते हैं कि बताएं ग्रेटर गुड फॉर द ग्रेटर नंबर ऑफ पीपल जो है सेक्रीफाई हो रहा है यहाँ पर इसको कैसे जस्टिफाई करूँ मैं उनको बिकॉज वेन यू आर नॉट गोइंग टू द मून सो बेसिकली यू आर नॉट अंडरस्टैंडिंग द कॉन्सेप्ट ऑफ ग्रेटर गुड फॉर द ग्रेटर नंबर ऑफ पीपल तो क्या इसको हम कनेक्ट कर सकते हैं दिस इज माई क्वेश्चन थैंक यू वेरी मच आई
एम गोइंग टू आस्क वासिफ टू आंसर दिस वन I only take difficult questions. The easy ones, I don't.
عبادت برق ہی کرتا ہوں اور افسوس حاصل کا it's a very seriously doubtful statement that going to the moon leads to collective good I مجھے نہیں لگتا کہ یہ دونوں باتیں میوچولی ایکسکلوسیو ہیں ان کا آپس میں کوئی جھگڑا ہے البتہ جو ڈاکٹر صاحب کہہ رہے تھے کہ as part of a beautiful natural biological family ہمارا پہلا اور ہزارواں اس سے بھی آگے کا جو فریضہ ہے وہ یہ ہے کہ پہلے ہم اپنے آپ میں انویسٹ کریں بجائے اس کے کہ وہ ایک ویکوس سی اسپیکٹیکل میں اور آپ پڑھ سکتے ہیں چاند پہ جانے کے پیچھے جو بھی کہانی تھی ایک اچھے بڑے ایسٹرو فزسسٹ ہیں مشہور بھی ہیں یوٹیوب وغیرہ پہ بھی آتے ہیں وہ خود اس کے بارے میں کوسچنز ریز کر رہے تھے نیل ڈی گراس ٹائسن کہ اس کے پیچھے جو عوامل تھے وہ بالکل کلیکٹیو گڈ کے نہیں تھے بہت سینیکل تھے وہ کمیونزم اور کیپٹلزم کا کوئی معاملہ تھا اور کینیڈی جو ہے وہ بڑے خطرناک سے پریزیڈنٹ تھے تو شاید یہ جو ڈاکٹر صاحب تھے یہ اسی طرف اشارہ کر رہے تھے یہ اسی زمانے کے تھے ہی ہیڈ گریٹ انسائٹ کہ وٹ سائنس واز آٹ ٹو ڈو انسٹیڈ آف ڈوئنگ وٹ ایور نان سینس دیٹ واز
السلام علیکم مائی نیم از زین منکانی آئی ایم این آرکیٹیکٹ my question is you said something very interesting at the start of your talk which was that the cancer cell is immortal and that struck me as very interesting and very ironic because you know here is a disease a fatal disease which may also hold the secret to immortality so my question to you is did your research ever focus on that aspect of the disease
question
very good question
I love that question thank you so much and you know there's something I forgot to say at the end shoot me I began my intellectual journey into oncology by asking these two questions how does a cancer cell become immortal and how does it become mobile And I think with the first cell being two fused cells, I'm able to answer both. Because, think of it, if a liver cell now sits inside a blood cell, what does the blood cell do? A blood cell can travel all over. And this is how a cancer cell becomes mobile. It's hitching a ride on a blood cell. This is my answer to the mobility. And how does it become immortal? By literally giving birth to a new life form by combining two genomes together. The re-engineering of the genomic process. So I came up with all this for many years. I've been following this trail. Only last week, a paper has been published in Nature Communications from China, in which they found that fused cells turn on a gene MYC, and c-MYC is the gene that can cause continuous proliferation. So fusion ends up by turning on genes that directly are responsible. So basically, you won't believe, Wasif, that all the new papers that are coming out are now, I'm being vindicated, because they are proving exactly what we have been saying. And another thing we did, which might interest you also, even though you are an architect, I'm very impressed that you asked such a deep question. Another thing one of my scientists in the lab did is he simply went to the public domain and pulled out all the data that are available on genetic sequencing of two groups of patients, colon cancer and breast cancer patients. And he just looked at the genetic expression of cells in single cell sequencing, which is available in the public domain. Anyone can go and pull out the data from cyberspace and do your own analysis. So my top scientist who's head of the program did this, pulled it down and said, hey, I now have the ability to look at every colon cancer that has been sequenced, every breast cancer that has been sequenced. Let me see if there are giant cells present here. And guess what he found? Fused genomes in every single cancer we looked at.
Wow.
Isn't that unbelievable?
So, Azra Raza, is there a bit of a paradox that the cell that wants to live forever is causing the most destruction?
Yes, that's what he pointed out also, and you're absolutely right that what Wasif said, existence and and annihilation coexist.
Interesting. Yeah.
Even,
another question.
Even our, by the way, I want to point out to you, Najib, that the difference between you and your brother is that your brother is an MD. An MD stands for money doctor. You are a PhD, and PhD stands for poor, hungry doctor.
It's the highest poverty.
And another thing I want to say.
A phakkar bhi ho sakta na. PH for phakkar doctor.
Salam, Azra Apa. I should call you Dr. Azra because I only know you through a very close friend of mine who sings your praises. My name is Zara Habib and I'm also a PhD phakkar doctor. But I work with children with developmental disabilities. And my question to you, before I ask you that question, I think that your journey embodies Yohsan because you are so passionate, it is palpable, and I love that about you. So the destination is not important, it's the journey that is important. My question to you, as medical people, we are so hung up on cure. I want your take on what is your definition of cure versus healing? Because according to Dr. Gabor Mate, he talks about healing in various different terms, and healing can also be cure. So I'd like your take on that.
What a beautiful question. One of my favorite topics, the difference between cure and healing. If somebody has an infection, you give them an antibiotic, they're cured of the infection. But that doesn't heal the violations that the person has undergone. So healing is a more holistic approach to curing the entire body, not just getting rid of a disease. And no one could have made this difference more beautifully apparent than Ghalib. The difference between cure and healing I found in the words of Ghalib as follows. Taufeeq ba andaaz-e himmat hai azal se. Jitna kaam karne ki aap mein taufeeq hai, it depends on your himmat. Are you willing to take the risks or not? So in our literature, there's a myth that it's the first few drops of the season's first rain. If they go into the heart of a clam, they become the pearls. So what about drops that didn't happen to be the first few? So first, Ghalib is saying here, he is trying to console those raindrops that weren't lucky enough to be the first. He's saying, don't worry about that. You weren't the first, so you're not going to become a pearl. What can you do now? Taufeeq ba andaaz-e himmat hai azal se, aankhon mein hai wo qatra jo gohar na hua tha. Yes, you didn't become a pearl, but now you have the chance of becoming a teardrop that comes out of the eye of a lover. And how much more important is that one drop compared to the inanimate dead pearl? And so pearl is itself, a pearl is beautiful. That is the healing part. That is the cure part, but the healing to me is the tear part. Can you share the tears with your patients or not?
Hi, my name's Komal Fatma. I'm a second year med student from Zaudin, and with me is my friend Sayyid Adali, who is an HO at Civil Hospital. And my question is, will you be giving this talk in med schools in Pakistan? Because we need to hear this more than anything right now. Because we are the people that are going to be coming to you, you know?
Right.
So.
The med schools have to be as awesome as Habib University first.
Awesome.
not going there.
I
humble suggestion is that you should simply, at Habib University as well as medical schools, you have one way to combine. You should just put in your curriculum the first cell.
First of all, a shair that I would dedicate to Azra Raza definitely would be Iqbal's. Khurshid jahan taab ki zaf tere sharar mein, abad hai ek taaza jahan tere hunar mein. First of all, Dr. Azra, thank you so much for coming. And I would also like to appreciate Dr. Wasif's attempt of having you here. My question would be that I am a student at Habib and I'm studying the Social Development and Policy Program. And I personally plan to pursue research as a profession. But considering that in Pakistan, we do not have heroes like you in any field of research who would excel at their work and in their field that much, for a person who actually aims to work in research as a professional, what would your one motive of inspiration would be for people like us?
I'm glad young people are standing up to ask the questions. Let me begin by completing what you started, which is something I taught my daughter when she was very young. The same thing. Khurshid jahan taab ki zau tere sharar mein. Abad hai ek taaza jahan.
Wow.
Tere jigar mein. Jachte nahi bakhshe huye firdaus nazar mein. Jannat teri pinha hai tere khune jigar mein. Ae pekare gil. How gorgeous is this line. Khurshid jahan taab ki zau tere sharar mein. Abad hai ek taaza jahan tere jigar mein. Jachte nahi bakhshe huye firdaus nazar mein. Jannat teri pinha hai tere khune jigar mein. Ae pekare gil koshishe peham ki jaza dekh. Khol aankh zami dekh, falak dekh, fiza dekh. Mashriq se ubharte huye suraj ko zara dekh. My advice to you young man and to all the young people who want to do research is work hard to make the environment for research possible. Because as I said, you can't simply decide I'm going to do research and go and open a laboratory and start doing. No, you need an entire infrastructure for the ability to even do the least amount of research. But don't let that be daunting. Start from the beginning. You start laying the foundation so that even if you don't end up actually reaping the benefit of it, the entire nation will reap the benefit as younger people come along. I think you need to stand up and insist that you want to do research and that this is the kind of thing that the nation's responsibility is to provide through the institutions to you. Do it today. Go and start on the quest. And again, I'd say, khol aankh, zami dekh, falak dekh, fiza dekh.
Yeah.
So,
I would say fiction first, but poetry is a bit hard.
Who has the microphone?
So we are, with permission, can we take a couple more questions, Azra Raza?
I'm all yours yes. for the evening.
Okay. Yes,
my name is Batul Ali. And we've met before. What I would like to ask you is that can cancer be a genetic disease or whatever you call it?
There are many reasons for cancer. Think of it like somebody gets pneumonia. Is pneumonia one disease? No. One person's pneumonia is caused by a virus. Another person's pneumonia is caused by a bacterial infection. A third person is caused because they were exposed to some toxins and it caused an inflammatory response. So the body knows how to respond only in one way to multiple damaging things. And you want to say something before I continue? Go ahead.
After you've completed your answer, there's one more question. One more thing I want to say why I'm saying this is because my grandfather suffered from cancer, but it was at a time when cancer wasn't discovered. And he was in Hyderabad, Dakhan, in the 1940s. And they said he was having a nervous breakdown. But after that, two of his daughters died of cancer. Then my son, Yasin, last year, He also passed away due to cancer because it was once taken care of in, I think, 2010. And then after that, it came back with a vengeance. And in 22, we lost him. What I worry about is that his children, God forbid, can something like this be carried on? Because as I told you, my grandfather and then two of my aunts, khalas, they also passed away due to this. So it is something that bothers me a lot, and keep praying, of course, for them. It's all in God's hands, but one needs to know. Thank you.
Thank you, Batul. As you know, I was involved with your son. He communicated many times with me, and so did you. And I'm very sorry about it. And please accept my deepest sympathies. So I think the answer is what you said yourself, that there is a higher susceptibility, but susceptibility can be made much worse by one's lifestyle, for example. So if there is a predisposition towards retaining a damage in a cell that can lead to cancer, it can be enhanced if the person smokes or has bad habits of not exercising, etc. All I can say is, while there is a higher susceptibility in a family like yours, it doesn't mean every member will get cancer, no. And one way to avoid right now, what we know is, really lead as healthy a life as possible. So your advice to your grandchildren should be, look, you are at a higher risk of getting cancer because of your family history. It is incumbent upon you now to protect yourselves by following very healthy habits. Do not smoke, do not drink, exercise, lead a good healthy lifestyle. And above all, when they reach a certain age, start monitoring for early detection of cancer. That is all I can suggest for your family, along with prayers.
Ramiz Ahmed, mera naam hai. Independent Urdu se mera taluk hai. Meri sister ke saath ek problem hai, pichle takriban 6 saal se. Cyst hai unko, ek aisi jagah pe, jahan par reproductive organs unke nikal liye gaye, takriban 80%. Aur main batate hue emotional ho jata hun. Ab problem ye hai ke IVF humne karwane ki koshish ki unki, lekin wo successful nahi hua. तो अब मैं थोड़ा सा बेरब्त हो जाता हूँ ये बात बताते हुए. मुझे ये जानना है कि क्या कुछ हो सकता है कि हम उनकी शादी बचा पाएँ, हम उन्हें बचा पाएँ, और क्या इसमें हो सकता है? क्योंकि आज के आपके लेक्चर को सुनने के बाद मुझे एक उम्मीद जागी है. और पिछले 6-7 साल से मैं अक्सा से भी ये बात कर रहा था कि आपने बहुत से शेर व शायरी का भी यहाँ पर तस्करा किया, तो मैं सिर्फ कंक्लूड करूँगा इस बात पर कि मुझे क्या बुरा था मरना अगर एक बार होता. थैंक यू.
सो सॉरी टू हेयर दिस, एंड आई एम वेरी सॉरी दैट यू हैड टू से ऑल दिस इन सच अ पब्लिक फोरम. आई एम श्योर इट रिक्वायर्ड अ लॉट ऑफ करेज. सो प्लीज नो दैट योर आवर हार्ट्स आर विद यू, एंड व्हाट यू एंड योर फैमिली आर सफरिंग. आई एम वेरी सॉरी टू हेयर दैट, बट आई एम श्योर देर इज गुड होप फॉर योर सिस्टर. वेदर इट विल सेव हर मैरिज और नॉट आई डोंट नो, बट डेफिनेटली there is no reason why someone who wants a child shouldn't be able to have one today. So have some faith, but more importantly, pursue the latest technology that is available to extract an egg from her body and to have a surrogate parent carry it. Any kind of thing can be done today. So yes, my answer is very hopeful.
Thank you all very much. And with that, we could have Mrs. Jamila Habib also come to the stage to present the award and gift.